Hello friends, good morning. So in this video we are going to learn how to design of riveted joint under eccentric loaded conditions. Okay, so there is a problem on the eccentric loaded riveted joint. Find the value of P, where P will be the load of the joint shown in the figure. Based on the working shear stress of 100 MPa. So this is working shear stress for the riveted joint, that is given as 100 MPa for the rivets. The four rivets are equal. So they have mentioned with the four rivets 1, 2, 3, 4. Each rivet of 20 mm diameter. Okay. So each rivet, so let me write the rivet numbering. So 1, 2, 3, 4. There are four rivets of equal size. The diameter is 20 millimeter, and where the load acts at a certain distance, this is the hole where the load's acting. Okay, so you need to calculate what is the load acting. Based on the working shear stress, you have to design. Okay, so now it is in a bracket, a system of riveting system. So here, first we will write the given values. The shear stress is given as 100 MPa, where shear stress we will be denote with tau is equal to 100 MPa. So where that is equal to in Newton per millimeter square, 100 1 Newton per millimeter square, where 1 MPa is equal to Newton per millimeter square. The diameter of the rivets, that is small d, is given as 20 millimeter for 4 rivets. And this is not the rivet, okay, this is a hole where the load is acting. So now what is the procedure in the eccentric loaded riveted joint, where the loads acts at a certain distance from the rivet system, and you have to calculate what is the first priority, is what is the direct shear stress. Second one, you have to calculate the, see here, the eccentricity from the rivet to the center of the riveted system to the load, it is not mentioned here, that is E. So E also you have to calculate, that is called as eccentricity. So you need to calculate the eccentricity in this problem, and again you have to calculate the turning moment that is P into E is the turning moment. Then third, you have to calculate the what are the secondary shear load. Secondary shear loads like F1, F2, F3 and F4. So these are the secondary rivets, and also you have to calculate the center of gravity of the riveting system. So CG you have to calculate. See, this element is an asymmetry element, symmetry about the y axis, so we can easily calculate the center of gravity of the system, because we have only rho. Then we have to calculate what is the length from center of gravity to the rivets, that is like L1, L2, L3 and L4 you have to calculate. Okay, after that you need to calculate the resultant force, that is RA, RB and RC, RD. So like that you have to calculate. So in the resultant forces you will have, where R is equal to, there will be a force ion plus the direct shear stress. So there you will get the unknown load which acts at a certain distance. So this is the solution to calculate the or to design the eccentric loaded riveted joints. Okay. So first we will calculate the direct shear stress. We know that the direct shear stress that is PS is equal to P by N. Okay. So now one more thing we have missed here. There are four rivets, means N is the number of rivets. In the given data you have to write N is equal to 4. So now we will calculate direct shear stress. So load is a unknown divided by 4. Okay, so P by 4. So now where 1 by 4 is equal to, it is 0.25 into P. So let us write this is equation number 1. Okay, now this direct loads are acts in the direction of the loads. So where PS, it will be acts in the direction of the P. So that is P, we will denote here PS, and this is the another one. Okay, so after that we will calculate the center of gravity. See, it is an asymmetry system. So the center of gravity for this system, it will be total the distance, it is 600. So at a distance of 300 you will have the CG. So this is CG. CG will be the center of gravity. So from the rivets 3 to CG, it is a distance of 100 millimeter. Okay, now this is also 100 CG distance. Okay, so we have calculated the center of gravity is calculated at a distance of rivet 3 to CG is 100 millimeter. Okay, so now we will calculate the turning moment. So before turning moment we will calculate the eccentricity, that is E is equal to, so eccentricity, it is the distance from load into the CG. So load is here at the node 3 and CG is here. So the distance, it will be 100 millimeter. So this distance we can say E is the eccentricity value. Okay, now we will calculate the turning moment. Turning moment, that is P into E. So load is unknown here and eccentricity is 100 millimeter. So 100 into Newton millimeter, and the direction of the load, it is towards the center of gravity, is an anticlockwise. The loads which is making towards CG in the anticlockwise direction. So we have to write anticlockwise direction. Okay, so after that we will calculate the secondary shear loads like F1, F2, F3 and F4. So before calculating the secondary shear load, you need to calculate the length of the each rivets from the center of gravity, that is L1. So first we will calculate the length from rivet 1 to the CG. Okay, so L1 to the CG is 200 plus 100, so that is equal to 300 millimeter. Okay, so similarly the length for rivet 4 to the CG, again it is 200 plus 100, so it is a length of rivet 1 and rivet 4 are same, so we can say L1 is equal to L4. Similarly, we will calculate for L2 and L3. It will be again same. See, from the center of gravity to the rivet 2 is 100 and center of gravity to rivet 3 is again 100. So, it will be 100 millimeter for the length of rivet 2 and rivet 3. So, once you calculated the length, then we will go for the secondary shear forces, that is F1, F2, F3 and F4. So, as we know that where the turning moment P into E is equal to F1 divided by L1, in the bracket there will be L1 square plus L2 square plus L3 square plus L4 square. So, this is the equation we have derived to calculate the secondary loads. Now, we will substitute the load as it is unknown and eccentricity is 100 is equal to F1. Is the secondary load divided by length of the length for the element 1, that is we have calculated 300 is equal to, see L1 and L4 are same, so we can write 2 because 2 into any one you can say, so L1 whole square, that is 300 whole square. Okay, so again L2 and L3 is same, so we have to write 2 into 100 square, so that is equal to we can calculate the so here we have to make the calculation some so where F1 is equal to P into 100 by into 3 divided by 2000. So, as we will get 0.15 into P is the F1 value. So, F1 is equal to 0.15 into P. So, you make the calculation here. So, you will get F1 is equal to 0.15 into P. Okay. So, similarly, we will calculate for the load to rivet 2, F2. So, F2 is equal to, it is F1 into L2 by L1. So, F1 is 0.15 P divided by into L2, L2 is 100 divided by L1 is 300. So, 100 into 0.15 divided by 300 is equal to 0.05 Newton. Okay, so similarly we will calculate for F3 is equal to again F1 L3 by L1. So, this value we will obtain directly, I will write. So, again it will be again 0.05 P. So, it will be P here. Again for F4 it is F1 L4 by L1. So, 0.01 into L4 is 300 divided by 100. So we will obtain 0.15 into P. Okay, so these are the secondary shear loads. F1, next this is F2 and it is F4. Okay, so all the secondary shear load we have calculated. Okay, so now we will calculate the resultant forces. So in the resultant forces we required the angle between the direct stress and the secondary stress, that is direct stress is PS and the secondary stress is F. Okay, so for each rivet where the secondary loads are, again they are also act right angles to the center of gravity, that is F2, F1 and F3, F4, these forces are acting perpendicular to the center of gravity. It means that the angle of inclination that will be 0 degree for all the rivets. So the resultant force we can directly write down for P and F. So the sign it will be plus or minus. Why it will be plus or minus, I will explain you. For the rivet 2 and rivet 1, the load which is making in the anti-clockwise direction, means for the rivet, suppose if you want to write the equation for 1, so R1 is equal to PS minus F1, because for the rivet 1 the making the turning movement in the anti-clockwise direction. Similarly for R2 it is PS minus F2. Okay, but for the resultant force for rivet 3 it is PS plus F3, because for the rivet 3 from the center of gravity it is making in the clockwise direction. Similarly for R4 PS plus F4. Okay, so now we will calculate R1. So R1 is nothing but substituting the PS, that is we have already calculated, that is 0.25 P minus F1. F1 is equal to 0.15 P. So here we will obtain 0.25 minus 0.15, that is 0.1 P is the R1 value. Now similarly we will calculate R2. R2 is equal to, directly we will substitute, PS is 0.25 minus F2 is 0.05, so that is equal to 0.2 P. Now R3 is PS plus F3, so PS is 0.25 plus F3 is 0.05, that is equal to 0.3 P. Now R4 is 0.25 plus 0.15, that is equal to 0.4 is the resultant forces. Okay, so we have the shear stress equation, the maximum shear stress equation, that is where R is equal to pi by 4 d square into tau. Okay, so R is equal to pi by 4 d square into tau. So this is the maximum resultant forces equation. So here out of these 4, the maximum value will be 0.4. so now the maximum shear load is 0.4, so we will write 0.4 P is equal to pi by 4 into D, we have given as 20 square, into tau is 100. Okay, so now we will get the load here from the calculation. So we will obtain 78.55 Newton is the load which are applied at here. So this is 78.55 Newton is the load. So thank you for watching. Please subscribe the channel.